Hello, and thank you again for coming along to Eco Views and News. Today we're going to continue our series on Grassroots Global by considering a very important person who, in fact, was in the news this last week for a very important reason. And that is, he's resigned his position as head of the Goddard Asser Institute at Columbia University and a climate scientist of the first order. He's reached retirement age, and he's decided to go full-time on climate activism at this point, devoting his energies in that direction, stepping down from his scientific position. You'll know who I'm talking about. It's Dr. James Hansen, and he's been in the news, as I say, this week. Amy Goodman aimed it up pretty well with a short piece on it and gave you a sense of the overview of the drama. Take a look the way she summed it up.
And the nation's leading climate scientist, Dr. James Hansen, is retiring after more than 40 years to focus on activism around fighting global warming. For over 25 years, Dr. Hansen has headed the Goddard Institute for Space Studies, NASA's premier climate research center. His testimony to a Senate committee in 1988 first brought the threat of global warming to the world's attention. Under the Bush administration, he went public to reveal the White House tried to silence his warnings about the urgent need to address climate change. He's since been arrested outside the White House for protesting mountaintop removal and the Keystone XL pipeline. Hansen says he now plans to devote his time to campaigning in the U.S. for the reduction of the greenhouse gases that cause global warming.
Okay, well, that's the story and the summation that Amy gave it this last week. We want to go a little bit further in depth as to why he has been such a key figure and what his approach has been in this grassroots global connection. As she mentioned, there was a key piece of testimony that he gave in 1988, and it's worth listening to the actual words of that, actually. He summarizes it himself, but here are his words on the 23rd of June in 1988, recorded by a BBC announcer, actually.
Barring a remarkable and improbable cooling, 1988 will be the warmest year on the record. Altogether, this evidence represents a very strong case, in my opinion, that the greenhouse effect has been detected and it is changing our climate now.
That was James Hansen, a NASA climate scientist, speaking a quarter century ago in a statement that proved prophetic. Over the course of a long career, Dr. Hansen was to make many more warnings like that, inspiring many environmentalists and angering many climate skeptics, up to and including the White House. On our cover this week, Justin Gillis reports exclusively that James Hansen is retiring from NASA to take his cause even more public. Justin joins us now to talk about his story. Justin Gillis, if there's a household name in the world of climate science, that name is probably James Hansen. But how did he come to this subject in the first place? NASA scientists study outer space, right?
That's what a lot of people think, and of course many people associate NASA mainly with moon landings in the 1960s and so forth, and it's actually an interesting scientific history. In that era, in the space age, we were beginning to get these measurements from satellites and launch craft of other planets, and so NASA scientists were sort of assigned to try to figure out what was going on. I mean, it was in that era that we were figuring out that Venus was really hot, for example. That Mars was really cold, and so people were working through the physics of all that, and it turns out that the same physics that tell you why the surface of Venus is hot enough to boil lead or melt lead and why Mars is sort of a frozen wasteland also tell you why the Earth is the temperature it is.
Okay, now this is crucial. As part of his work on other planets in the solar system, Jim Hansen comes to a realization, along with the other climate scientists at the time, that we're not unique in having an atmosphere. A lot of planets have an atmosphere, and a lot of planets have had different histories in their atmosphere. Their atmosphere has changed over time. It would be very strange if that weren't the case for Earth. And he said to himself, starting on another planet, maybe I better focus on Earth itself and take a look at its changing climate. This he does after the 1988 hearings. Here he is in the middle of that panel. Others were very distinguished as well, including Dr. Bill Mumaw, who's sitting down here on this end of the panel. He now teaches at Tufts and teaches a course on climate change online, which you can get access to. Bill McKibben wrote in that same year a very important book on the death of nature, and he too took up the cause, largely echoing and expanding upon what Jim Hansen was saying in the scientific circles. As you recall, last time we emphasized that Bill McKibben was a primary grassroots global thinker, and that he's making an appeal right now to divestment in religious institutions. You'll recall that Bill himself addresses people regularly in the basement of churches. It's really quite interesting. He has a direct appeal from the church tradition, but so does Dr. Hansen. In this case, you'll see he was addressing the National Religious Coalition on Creation Care, NRCC as it's called, back in 2012, just about a year ago, a little less than a year ago, he addressed them and in effect drew the connection directly to Bill, because he gets a lot of inspiration from Bill's activity and Bill gets his science from Jim Hansen. Listen to the introductory remarks that make that very clear. Let's see if we can call it up here. This was a session entitled The Climate Change Summit, Integrating Scientific, Religious, and Cultural Implications of Climate Warming. Okay, that's a straightforward tribute on the part of Jim Hansen to Bill McKibben, and the two of them, in effect, echo each other's work very directly and continuously ever for the last 10 years or so. In fact, ever since 1988, since Bill wrote that initial book. And we've heard him here in Cambridge. I don't know if you've attended these things, but the Cambridge Forum invited Jim Hansen to come speak not long ago, and there's actually a full-length available video of the talk off of their website. So you should take the chance to look at it when you can. It's pretty impressive. He goes through, in this case, without any slides, because he was talking again in a church which had no projection capability.
Turn their attention to after Copenhagen. What should citizens be doing? Dr. James Hansen first brought global warming to the world's attention in 1980 when he was the first to testify at great length before Congress. Since then, he has pursued a distinguished career in research, measuring current climate trends and projecting humankind's potential impact on climate in a series of robust models. He's an adjunct professor at the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences at Columbia University and at Columbia's Earth Institute, and director of the NASA Goddard Institute for Space Studies. And he has continued to bring the problem of global climate change to a broad public audience, appearing in 60 Minutes, ABC News Tonight, Anderson Cooper, Charlotte Rose, and NPR. He's been interviewed in the New York Times and profiled in the New Yorker, and has written for the Boston Globe, The Nation, New York Review of Books, and Scientific American. After literally writing hundreds of professional and sometimes popular articles, Mr. Hansen has just published his first book. Now, this is actually quite interesting to academics because we usually rail against the world on a regular basis, saying the trouble with the world out there is they haven't yet read the book that I haven't yet written. Well, the fact is, he wrote the book then. So we can all get a copy and get it signed afterwards. But in fact, he's gone beyond the confines of the scientific research and addressed in this particular book, as you can tell from the title, Storms of Migrant Children, directly the problem of intergenerational ethical responsibility. Welcome in the forum.
Thanks very much for this opportunity to discuss this problem, which this issue, this matter, which doesn't need to be a problem, but we have to discuss it as one, because if we stay on the track that we're on, it's going to be a big problem for our children and our grandchildren.
Okay. For our children and our grandchildren. In fact, that's the whole theme that his book takes on. Having written most of his work in his professional career in technical journals, he turns around now and talks to a popular audience, usually in churches, as in the Cambridge Forum circumstance here. But he also gave a very impressive summation of how he got to where he is today, and a very crystalline analysis of how desperate it is in a TED Talk. TED Talks are seen nationally now, and they're available on the web. So you can take a look at an autobiographical statement here that's really quite powerful. Take a look.
What do I know that would cause me, a reticent Midwestern scientist, to get myself arrested in front of the White House protesting? And what would you do if you knew what I know? Let's start with how I got to this point. I was lucky to grow up at a time when it was not difficult for the child of a tenant farmer to make his way to the state university. And I was really lucky to go to the University of Iowa, where I could study under Professor James Van Allen, who built instruments for the first US satellites. Professor Van Allen told me about observations of Venus, that there was intense microwave radiation. Did it mean that Venus had an ionosphere, or was Venus extremely hot? The right answer, confirmed by the Soviet Venera spacecraft, was that Venus was very hot, 900 degrees Fahrenheit. And it was kept hot by a thick carbon dioxide atmosphere. I was fortunate to join NASA and successfully propose an experiment to fly to Venus. Our instrument took this image of the Veil of Venus, which turned out to be a smog of sulfuric acid. But while our instrument was being built, I became involved in calculations of the greenhouse effect here on Earth, because we realized that our atmospheric composition was changing. Eventually, I resigned as principal investigator on our Venus experiment because a planet changing before our eyes is more interesting and important. It changes will affect all humanity. The greenhouse effect had been well understood for more than a century. British physicist John Tyndall in the 1850s made laboratory measurements of the infrared radiation, which is heat, and he showed that gases such as CO2 absorb heat, thus acting like a blanket, warming Earth's surface. I worked with other scientists to analyze Earth climate observations. In 1981, we published an article in Science magazine concluding that observed warming of 0.4 degrees Celsius in the prior century was consistent with the greenhouse effect of increasing CO2, that Earth would likely warm in the 1980s, and warming would exceed the noise level of random weather by the end of the century. We also said that the 21st century would see shifting climate zones, creation of drought-prone regions in North America and Asia, erosion of ice sheets, rising sea levels, and opening of the fabled Northwest Passage. All of these impacts have since either happened or are now well underway. That paper was reported on the front page of the New York Times and led to me testifying to Congress in the 1980s. Testimony in which I emphasized that global warming increases both extremes of the Earth's water cycle. Heat waves and droughts on one hand directly from the warming, but also because a warmer atmosphere holds more water vapor with its latent energy, rainfall will become in more extreme events. There will be stronger storms and greater flooding. Global warming hoopla became time-consuming and distracted me from doing science, partly because I had complained that the White House altered my testimony. So I decided to go back to strictly doing science and leave the communication to others. By 15 years later, evidence of global warming was much stronger. Most of the things mentioned in our 1981 paper were facts. I had the privilege to speak twice to the President's Climate Task Force, but energy policies continue to focus on finding more fossil fuels. By then, we had two grandchildren, Sophie and Connor. I decided that I did not want them in the future to say, "Opa understood what was happening, but he didn't make it clear."
Okay, well, you can see that's the immediate motivation. He had grandchildren, and that he doesn't want to be known as the person who understood what was happening, but didn't make it clear. So it's hit to his grandchildren that he attributes the motivation to go to the next phase of things. And it's quite an amazing phase. Look at the way he phrases it.
By then, we had two grandchildren, Sophie and Connor. I decided that I did not want them in the future to say, "Opa understood what was happening, but he didn't make it clear." So I decided to give a public talk criticizing the lack of an appropriate energy policy. I gave the talk at the University of Iowa in 2004 and at the 2005 meeting of the American Geophysical Union. This led to calls from the White House to NASA headquarters, and I was told that I could not give any talks or speak with the media without prior explicit approval by NASA headquarters. After I informed the New York Times about these restrictions, NASA was forced to end the censorship. But there were consequences. I had been using the first line of the NASA mission statement to understand and protect the home planet to justify my talks. Soon the first line of the mission statement was deleted, never to appear again.
Now that's pretty extraordinary. That's the censorship that appeared from the White House, and it was pretty direct and explicit, not leaving any room for doubt. Basically, this is what's led to the series of articles and in fact a full-length book called Censoring Science, which details how NASA actually changed its mission statement, which was initially to understand and protect the home planet, And it crossed that out. I mean, it just completely did away with that because it didn't like hearing what it was hearing from this lead government climate scientist. And it tried to shut him up. He basically said, forget it. I'm going to tell this to the American people. It needs to be told. And if you want to arrest me, you can. But the fact is, the scientists have an obligation to tell the public what is going on. And he did. It's pretty extraordinary. Take a look at what he went on to do. He published a book. This was the first book that was mentioned in the Cambridge Forum that he came up with. And if you look at the subtitle of it, it's The Truth About the Coming Climate Catastrophe and Our Last Chance to Save Humanity. It's pretty dramatic for a research scientist like this to come up with language like this. Take a look why.
Over the next few years, I was drawn more and more into trying to communicate the urgency of a change in energy policies while still researching the physics of climate change. Let me describe the most important conclusion from the physics. First, from Earth's energy balance, and second, from Earth's climate history. Adding CO2 to the air is like throwing another blanket on the bed. It reduces Earth's heat radiation to space, so there's a temporary energy imbalance. More energy is coming in than going out.
Okay, and then he goes through that explanation, and you should pick it up off of the TED website. It's pretty extraordinary. It's an important set of explanations. He gives the most intricate of scientific explanations here, but then he takes the issue to the public as well, as he puts it in the demonstration outside of the White House.
Well, the point is to try to get the public aware of what's going on. The importance of tar sands is that it's the first step, first big step, into unconventional fossil fuels. And what we know from the science is we cannot burn the unconventional fossil fuels and put the carbon into the atmosphere without leaving our children and grandchildren a situation that's out of their control.
Okay. It's going to be out of their control, the children and grandchildren, if we use these fossil fuels. It's not that we're running out of fossil fuels, it's that we can't live with the consequences of using them. This is what he's saying very explicitly. And more recently, in February, he was down in Washington again, pointing this out.
Well, I think the most important thing that my colleagues and I have come up with in recent years is the fact that if we burn all of the fossil fuels, more than half of the planet will be uninhabitable by humans. So it makes absolutely no sense to be going after every fossil fuel we can find. We're going to have to leave the dirtiest ones like the tar sands, tar shale, fracking for gas. We're going to have to leave those in the ground. Otherwise, we're going to create a situation in which we will have an unlivable planet for our grandchildren and future generations.
Okay, what's going to be unlivable about it is, again, something he is very explicit about, and it's worth looking at it in his various speeches. In particular, he's talking about sea level rise. Take a look.
Well, I think that the concept of adapting to the climate change is really a dangerous one, because there is the potential for climate effects which humanity practically cannot adapt. The ice sheets become unstable, the sea level goes up multiple meters, and eventually tens of meters. Well, you're going to put all of the cities on coasts all around the world under.
All the cities on the coast, all around the world, are going to be underwater. And that means specifically Boston. If you haven't taken a look at how close we are to sea level, this is what he's saying is going to happen. This is why the man is really quite a visionary. Grassroots global, in the sense of grassroots leadership and global vision. And we ought to pay attention to everything he says in the coming weeks as he, in effect, retires to do this more full time. Thank you very much for coming along. Keep in touch, online or on air.